Why was Officer Tippett in Oak Cliff normal beat? Those who believe there was a conspiracy involving the Dallas police force have maintained that the meeting between Oswald and Tippett was not an accident, that Tippett may have been looking for Oswald or vice versa. They say Tippett should not have been where he was and should not have been alone in the squad car. Eddie Barker talked to police radio dispatcher Murray Jackson.
Officer Jackson, a lot of critics of the Warren report have made quite a thing out of the fact that Officer Tippett was not in his district when he was killed. Could you tell us how he happened to be out of his district?
Yes, Eddie, I have heard this several times since the incident occurred. He was where he was because I had assigned him to be where he was in the central Oak Cliff area. There was the shooting involving the president, and we immediately dispatched every available unit to the Triple Underpass, where the shot was reported to have come from. I realized that, as you said, that we were draining the Oak Cliff area of available police officers, so if there was an emergency, such as an armed robbery or a major accident, to come up, we wouldn't have anybody there that would be in any close proximity to answer the call. And since J.D. was the outermost unit, actually I had two units, 87, which was Officer Nelson, and 78, which was Officer Tippett.
Well, now, as you got down toward the time when Officer Tippett met his death, what transpired right prior to that? Were you aware of where he was all the time?
No, I asked him once again what his location was sometime after, and to determine that he was in the Oak Cliff area. He said he was at Lancaster and 8th, which is on the east side of Oak Cliff, but in the main business district. And I did ask once again a few minutes later I called him to ask him his location so I could keep track of him, where he was in my mind, but he didn't answer.
When did you realize that he was dead?
We had received a call from a citizen. They called us in on the telephone, and the call sheet came to me. And it was a disturbance in the street in the 400 block of East 10th. And I had called, I said 78, and he didn't answer. And almost immediately to this, a citizen came in on police radio and said, send me some help, there's been an officer shot out here. And knowing that J.D. was the only one that should have been in Oak Cliff, my reaction was to call 78. And of course, J.D. didn't answer. So we asked the citizen to look at the number on the side of the car. This was the equipment number that determined which patrol car was to be on each assigned district. And they said that it was number 10, and since I had worked with J.D. in this particular car, well, I determined to myself that with him not answering in the equipment number, that this was Officer Tippett.
The answer to this question is that he had been sent to Oak Cliff by the police dispatcher. Opponents of the Warren report maintain that Officer Tippett was shot not by Oswald, but by others. Who shot Officer Tippett? Eddie Barker talked to two witnesses who were on the scene of the Tippett murder. First, Domingo Benavides, who was at the wheel of a truck across the street from the scene.
As I was driving down the street, I seen this police car was sitting here, and the officer was getting out of the car, and apparently had been talking to the man that was standing by the car. The policeman got out of the car, and as he walked past the windshield of the car, where they'd kind of lined up over the hood of the car, well, then this other man shot him. And, of course, he was reaching for his gun. And I was standing there, sitting there in the truck, and not in no big hurry to get out. Of course, I was sitting there watching everything. This man turned from the car then, and took a couple steps. Then, as he turned to walk away, he was unloading his gun, and he took the shells, held them in his hand, and as he took off, he threw them in the bushes, more or less like really trying to get rid of them. I guess he didn't figure he was caught anyway, so he just threw them in the bushes. But as he started to turn and walk away, he stopped and looked back at me, and I didn't know if he figured, well, I'll just let this poor guy go, or he has nothing to do with it, or, I'm not out to kill everybody, just, whoever gets in my way, I guess. I give him enough time to get around the house, thinking he might have went in the house. I sat there for maybe a second or two, and then jumped out of the truck and run over. As I walked by, I didn't even slow down. I see the officer's dead, so I just walked in, got in the car, and I figured that would be the fastest way. In fact, I don't even know why I called him on the radio. I just figured now that it was the fastest way to get a police officer out.
Hello, police operator.
Go ahead. It says news and you get
police. Hello, we've heard a shooting out here.
What is it at? It says the news and police radio. What location?
Between Marcellus and Buckley. It's a police officer. Somebody shot him. What's it?
4th
Street. It's in a police car.
Number 10.
Hello, police officer. Did you get that?
Between police officer, 510 East Jefferson.
Thank you.
35.
It says the news and police radio will remain off the radio now.
Well, now, did several other people come up later?
Immediately afterwards. I mean, it was just... Oh, after people, I guess, a block away, like Mr. Calloway, he come up and he says, let's go get him or something. And then this cab pulled up right afterwards. And so Calloway went over and took the officer's gun out of his hand.
But Calloway did go after him, didn't he?
Yeah, Calloway took off to go try to catch him.
Well, Eddie, I was standing on the front porch of the used car lot that I worked on here. And all of a sudden, I heard some shooting. In fact, I heard 5 shots coming from the direction behind the lot over on 10th Street there. Well, I come running off the side of the porch and out to the sidewalk here, and I looked up the street and I saw this man run through this hedge up here on the corner. And I saw right away that he had a gun in his hand, and then he continued across the street coming in this direction. Well, when he got right across from me over here, just about 30 yards or less, why, I called to him and just asked him, hey, man, what the hell's going on? Because that's just exactly what I wondered. I didn't know who he was at the time, of course. And he looked in my direction and paused, almost stopped, and said something to me, but I couldn't make out what he said. But he had this pistol in his hand, carried in what we used to in the Marine Corps call a raised pistol position. And then he slowed down and started walking. Then I ran to the corner, 10th and Patton, and when I got there, I saw this squad car parked near the curb, and then I walked around in front of the squad car, and this policeman was lying in front of a squad car.
Tom, what about those expended shells?
Well, they were looking all over the place for evidence, I guess, and taking fingerprints and what have you. So I guess they was going to walk off and leave him, you know, not knowing it was there, and seeing I knew where they was at, I walked over and picked up a stick and picked them up and put them in a Winston package. I think I picked up 2 and put them in a Winston package, and then as I was walking back, I picked the other one up by hand, I believe, and I picked them up with a stick, you know, keep them leaving fingerprints on them, because I figured they might need them.
The cartridges that Benavides picked up were positively identified as being fired in Oswald's revolver, but only 1 of the 4 lead bullets removed from Officer Tippett's body could be positively identified with that revolver by Illinois ballistics identification expert Joseph Nichols.